Joining us now to discuss the outlook for the AI trade is Jack Hidary, CEO of AI and quantum software firm SandboxAQ. Jack, it's good to have you. Is there any reason for investors to rethink just sort of the speed to profitability and the payoff around all this spending around AI from your perspective?
So good to see you. And here in the Gulf region where there is unabated demand for AI, you're seeing a transformation of the Gulf region with AI, both AI for the digital world and AI for the physical world. We're seeing demand, and that is going to drive more for the companies that you just mentioned and more for data centers. Masa-san regretted the fact that he sold Nvidia stock years and years ago. He was on stage with Jensen talking about that just about a year ago. And I think he's going to probably regret this again, his sale today.
You just announced a new deal with Nvidia for AI for Catalyst. What's the significance of this? What does it do?
Well, the AI for the digital world, which is ChatGPT, Gemini, these are great tools, tools that are super useful. And that's what has created this massive challenge of creating all these data centers. AI for the physical world, the kind of AI that we just announced with Nvidia, AI that can create new kinds of battery chemistry. Catalyst, Sarah, as you know, are the elements that drive all manufacturing in this world. 80% of manufacturing needs catalysts. The energy industry absolutely needs catalysts. We in the United States throw away 40% of the electrons that we create at night. Instead of throwing it away, we could have newer kinds of battery chemistries, put those electrons in batteries, and have more power for these data centers. We are not efficient in how we use electricity in the U.S. and around the world. So AI for the physical world, what Jensen and I have been talking about, and the release that we did at the NVIDIA GTC around the first AI model to model these new chemical compounds that drive reactions forward faster and lower the energy you need to make these reactions. Catalysts are the essential. And this AI for the physical world is going to help solve the challenge that AI for the digital world has created for us.
Right. Namely power, Jack. It's David.
You got it.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I'm going to talk a bit more about the whole math around the ownership of NVIDIA by SoftBank and everything else there. But he's using the proceeds, Masa, from the NVIDIA sale to invest in OpenAI. You just indicated he's going to regret not having kept it. Do you think OpenAI is not as good an investment or won't return as much, if not more, than owning NVIDIA?
I think OpenAI is a great company, and I think it's now become an essential tool for many companies and many individuals as well. But I do think there's a lot of upside in where NVIDIA is going. And the reason is that we're just at the beginning of the story of AI. When we talk about the AI trade, to your point, to Sarah's point, we got to widen the aperture. People are too focused on large language models. We got to widen that aperture and say, if we're just going to talk about getting returns on our investment based on people using it for document summaries and customer service, we are not going to be happy. The bubble will not end well. But if we're thinking of the energy sector, in terms of the biopharma sector, in terms of logistics, in terms of humanoid robotics, then I think we can actually make this AI trade work. But I don't think it works if you're just focused on AI for the sliver of the economy that is digital, as opposed to 80% of the economy that is physical.
But you believe that will continue to stimulate demand for NVIDIA's GPUs for years to come, I suppose, and the software that goes along with them.
I do. And I think we may have even a graphic of the pace at which NVIDIA is changing its and updating its chips. Even as they roll out Blackwell, they announced Vera Rubin specs 10 days ago. Vera Rubin is going to roll out, and when that rolls out, they're announcing the next one. So we've seen unabated innovation. If I saw NVIDIA slacking in terms of the innovation in not only the chips themselves, but as importantly, David, we got to think about the system. And that's why their announcement with NVQ Link is also important. We got to think about ultimately a hybridized scenario where we have GPUs, CPUs, but also QPUs, quantum processing units. And that's what we just announced in the industry, the connection between the GPUs and the quantum computers.
Yes, so it's a good thing we have you because this wasn't even on the radar. So NVQ Link is what and why is it important and that NVIDIA is now positioning itself for quantum? And how does it relate to what you do? And, you know, we have Rigetti on next hour, increasingly, you know, hot trade around quantum.
Absolutely. Rigetti is an example of a superconducting quantum computer. There's seven major ways to build a quantum computer. On screen here, we see IonQ with trapped ion. We see Rigetti with superconducting. There's Psi Quantum and others on the private side, yet to go public. And so these seven ways of building a quantum computer speak a fundamentally different language than GPUs and CPUs, classical chips. And so we need literally the link to bring them together. And that's what Jensen just announced at the GTC in Washington just 10 days ago. The way to link, and so the link itself is fiber, the fiber that we're all familiar with. What's novel here is the protocol, the communication handshaking between these two very different worlds of compute. We're going to have to get used to these data center conversations we're having now starting to include the hosting of not just lots of racks of GPUs, but these novel kinds of quantum computers that need liquid helium, that need all kinds of other support. We just had CoreWeave on the show here. And when Michael and others think about the data center of the near future, this is not years from now, this is coming up soon, we're going to have to be thinking about quantum computers in those data centers as well.
Yeah, that's a whole nother conversation for another day. But no, but it's heating up. I mean, Arvind Krishna last week told me that there's a use case. The HSBC used the IBM quantum computer to improve basically algorithmic bond trading pricing, which is actually something we can understand.
Yeah, the financial service is going to be one application area. We got to wait a number of years. We're going to see the big impact of quantum computers more in the 4-5 year time frame from now rather than today. But that example of IBM and HSBC was a good example of the kinds of use cases we're looking for. At SandboxAQ, we're a software company. We're writing our software both for the GPU today, but also to incorporate the QPU of tomorrow. That combo package is going to be very powerful to solve biopharma problems, battery storage, the kind of storage we need right now for the energy demands that we're seeing in the marketplace. We just had the big gathering in Abu Dhabi out here in the Gulf, where we brought together the CEOs of the big energy companies. We had Bruce at Brookfield. We had Bio from BlackRock, GIP. We had the major investors in data centers. And we had the AI companies all in one room. This is the conversation that needs to happen right now.
You're a popular guy in the Middle East. I saw it firsthand in Riyadh, Jack, doing a lot of deals over there. Thank you for joining us.
Great to see you all.
Jack Hidary of SandboxAQ.